condemning me. Don't condemn me. Why are you always condemning me? Why are you always judging me? That's from Nacho Libre. When God gives us correction, it's not condemnation. Don't take it as condemnation when God gives you correction, because he loves you. My small child is running towards the street. Well, I don't want to correct them because they might feel condemned. I'm just going to, no, stop. Get back over here. Don't you run into the street. My teenager is, I get a message. Hey, I saw your teenager driving down the interstate the other day, and she was doing a really good job of texting, putting on her makeup, eating a Big Mac, and I just thought you should know that. Well, you know, I don't want to condemn her, so I'm not going to correct her. No, you correct her. Put the phone down. Put the makeup brush down. You know, you want to keep your car? Why do we do that? Because we want to condemn them. No, because we love them, and we want them to survive to make it to wherever they're going. God loves us. That's why he gives us correction. God loves us. He has this beautiful plan. He's got this, it's like we're bowling with the bumpers up. Have you ever watched somebody have fun bowling with the bumpers up? They don't know they're supposed to put the bumpers down. They like the bumpers. Bethany could like bounce it off four times and get a strike. It was like the most amazing, cool thing ever. The bumpers were up. She could do whatever she wanted in there. Christians, be okay with the fact that God's got the bumpers up. And he's got the Holy Spirit saying, here's what you do. And remember, we want to be like Jesus. And Jesus did what? What he heard his father say. He did what his father told him to do. He would only speak those things. The last thing that I want to say before, I'm just going to ask you to come forward and pray with us. Our Sunday night class is so awesome, and probably tonight would be the last night that you'd want to join late. So if you've been thinking about it, come tonight. We can get you caught up. We've got plenty of books. But one of the things that he said last week was super powerful. He said most of us think of God is the mean one and Jesus is the kind one. God is the one waiting to thump us with a lightning bolt, and Jesus is there to shield us and to protect us. I remember one time, I believe it was Sarah. She wasn't very old. Sally's a justice person, so you know, I'm sure you're shocked by the fact that I'm not the disciplinarian in the family. And Sarah, for whatever heinous thing she had done, I'm sure it was horrible. Sally would always paddle, but she used what we called a rod. It was really just a wooden ruler or something like that. Please do not call child services. She obviously turned out okay. And so whatever it was, and the decision was made, punishment was going to be dealt out, and the first smack, the second smack, and then the third smack. Guess where the third smack hit? It hit right here. Because I reached in like that. That too was enough. And I took the third one for her. You owe me for that, by the way. Okay, but Sally wasn't doing it because she didn't love her. It was out of love. But let me make the bigger point. God is not the mean one and Jesus is the sweet one. Here's how I know that. Jesus didn't do anything the Father didn't say to do. So the Father said, just burn them all. Just singe them all. Love them. Give yourself to them. Meet their needs. God even says, I'm not the judge. Jesus is the judge. And Jesus is saying, and I'm not judging today. I'm not condemning today. God is the source of Jesus' love. God is the author of the love. Remember, it doesn't say that Jesus so loved the world that he gave himself. It said that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. See, all this stuff is originating with the Father God. He's a good daddy. Don't be afraid of him. Some of us are brought up in a religious culture where, you know, you gotta show reverence. You gotta show reverence. You can't call God Abba. That was Only Jesus could do that. You can't call God. I had a problem for the longest time when people would say, and so Papa God, and I'm like, yeah, that just feels weird. You're supposed to get down on your knees, and you're supposed to prostrate yourself, and you're supposed to throw ashes over your head. That's exactly how I like my children to approach me. No. I want them to jump up in my lap. I want them to hug me. I want to kiss on them. That's the way God loves you. Here's how I'd like to end the service. For those of you who'd like to, we have got the cross back there. We have some really comfortable pillows back there. We have some almost comfortable pads up here. I'm hoping that we can really begin to develop our love for prayer as a church. So I'm just going to ask you, I'm just going to ask you if you're comfortable with finding a spot somewhere up here in the front. It's an altar call, not like the your buses will wait altar call. It's just an altar. I just want you, would you come and pray with me at the altar? Just pray that God would move through our country, that God would move through our state, that God would move through our church, and that God would move through you. To just experience him, to just know him like you've never known him before, to see his love like you've never seen it before. I'm serious, y'all. I have been consumed by some pretty stupid stuff. To be consumed by Jesus the same way I'm consumed by bitterness sometimes, that would be awesome. That would change my life, and it would change your life too. So whatever it is that the Holy Spirit's laying on your heart to pray for, pray that the heater would stop working, because apparently it's working overtime, but let's just do that. So you come forward if you're willing to. If you're not, that's completely understandable. There is no judgment if you don't want to do that. And if you, when you're ready to leave, you can just go right out the door. But come on, if y'all will join me at the altar.